as the president of Supreme Court Bar Association. Sir's first cabinet level assignments were in 2004 when he took on the portfolios for both science and technology and ocean development. And in 2009, Sir became the Minister for Human Resource Development. The following year, under his initiative, the Parliament passed a law that required the government to provide free and elementary education to all the children between the ages of 6 and 14. In January 2011, Sir was also made Minister for Communications and Information Technology. In 2013, Sir was given the additional portfolio of Law and Justice. He was a beacon of light who led the introduction of some remarkable changes in the school curriculum, like the introduction of continuous comprehensive evaluation. Sir also laid the foundation stone of IIT Patna and approved the conception of IIT in Bodinaheli. Sir is surely a man of many personalities. His love for collecting paintings and his penchant for poetry only adds up to his charismatic personality. He writes in 3 languages and written books such as Eyewitness, The World Within. The book Eyewitness is a collection of pensive and sharp poems on contemporary themes, and in Sir's own words are the thoughts cascading through his mind. Sir has also written songs for Jimmy Shergill's movie Shorgul, and the singers like Arijit and Hariharan has also used his lyrics for songs which are in the pipeline for release. A snippet that he wrote around Nirbhaya case in 2012 also outpours his tender heart as an individual. I will read few lines from that poem. Aankh khulli azad thi main, azadi mein zanjeerein kyun, mere bhi kuch apne the, bedardi se dafnaye kyun. Sir has also been honored with the prestigious Padma Bhushan Award in 2006 for his distinguished services in the field of public affairs. He also writes columns in the leading dailies. To be able to listen to these experiences and views on law from a stalwart such as Mr. Sibal himself is indeed a blessing for all of us. Before concluding Sir's introduction, I would like to share that last night I was telling my father about Sir and the event, and I told him that I'll be giving the introduction. So my father, who is also a poet by heart, composed few lines for you, sir. I would like, with your permission, I would like to read, sir. कैसे जिया जाए जीवन ये बताया आपने, स्वप्न देखा और सब सच कर दिखाया आपने, छू भी ली ऊंचाइयां पर नम्रता बाकी रही, सरल होना कठिन है पर कर दिखाया आपने. थैंक यू सर. Now I would like to move on to the introduction of moderators of today's session. The first moderator of today's session is Mr. Sunil Fernandez. Sunil sir is an advocate on record and a very prominent face in the Supreme Court corridors. Sunil sir's major practice is in Supreme Court and Delhi High Court. He was born and schooled in Bombay. He topped his Mumbai University in BA Honours Political Science. He completed his Master's Political Science from Hindu College and LLB from Campus Law Center, Delhi University. Sunil sir has represented the then state of Jammu and Kashmir as its standing counsel in the Supreme Court for over 5 years and was recently the additional advocate general for the state of Madhya Pradesh in the Supreme Court. Sunil sir's office is a flag bearer for most of the cases filed by Indian National Congress in the Supreme Court. I welcome you, sir, for today's session. The co-moderator for today's session is Mr. Shivang Dubey. Mr. Dubey belongs to the family of lawyers. He graduated from Hidayatullah National Law University in the year 2011. After graduation, he joined the chambers of Sri P.S. Koshi in the year 2011, who has been elevated as judge in the year 2013. Thereafter, Mr. Dubey opted to pursue LLM from Cardiff University in commercial law. After completing his post-graduation, he returned to India and joined chambers of the then senior advocate Ms. Indu Malhotra. Later on, she was elevated as a judge of the Supreme Court of India. At present, Mr. Dubey is practicing before Chhattisgarh High Court and on the panels of Bar Council of India, Chhattisgarh Power Holding Company, Chhattisgarh State Electricity Regulatory Commission, and Punjab National Bank. Thank you, Shivang, for joining the session today. Before we start today's event, I would like to mention on behalf of the foundation that this foundation is conceived with the objective of helping the financially underprivileged but meritorious students in all 25 national universities of the country. The foundation has two flagship projects, namely Project Eklavya and Project Dhananjay. Under the scheme of Project Eklavya, financially unsound students across national universities are selected by a distinguished panel of legal experts through a rigorous process and are then financially aided and mentored by the foundation. Project Dhananjay, on the other hand, is the financial extend the financial support to newly admitted members of the bar, and these graduates are paid a monthly stipend for sustaining themselves for initial 1 year of legal practice. Last year, in the inaugural function in November 2019, the foundation provided scholarships of 14 lakhs to 12 students from various national universities. Currently, we are in the process of implementing Project Dhananjay. We have selected 4 graduates whom we are providing a stipend of rupees 15 to 18,000 per month from July 2020 onwards. With this, I would request Mr. Achyut Tiwari to run a short PPT about the work foundation is doing to empower the legal education in the country. Over to you, Achyut.
I request the moderators to please take the mic.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
It's a pleasure and an honor both to have you here at this webinar. So you are into your fifth decade of an illustrious legal career. And there are 1,100 reported judgments in your name. A cursory search of the SEC case, so a search engine would reveal that. And this is despite a 10-year hiatus that you took. You know, you were a minister in UPA 1 and UPA 2. Despite that, sir, we have 1,100 of your cases reported. The first one was in February 1974, And the latest one is the Arnab Goswami one in just last month in June 2020. So, sir, it's a massive honor for us and we look forward to learn from you from this webinar. So if I could just start, sir, right from the beginning, you know, so your father was an illustrious senior advocate himself. Mr. H.K. Sibal was the then Advocate General of Punjab. So in your while you were growing up, was law a default option, sir? Or is it something that you were initially resistant to and later on you decided to pick up the gown? So what was the...
First of all, before I start and respond to you, I have to congratulate the CAN Foundation for the wonderful work that they are doing. I think when we reach out through Eklavya programs and through Jananjay to those students who don't have the capacity to undertake a journey in law school, I think CAN Foundation is doing fabulous work. But let me go back to, this is the kind of thing that I grew up, the environment that I grew up in had this element in it. My father was an enormously generous man. He would embrace the world. You know, anybody who came to his doorstep was never returned without a hearing, even as a lawyer. And, you know, we grew up in an environment where we were taught to do things for others. We were taught to understand the pains of those and the pain of those who come to you for succor. And we are also living in an environment where poetry, literature was part of everyday life. My father used to tell me wonderful stories about Lahore and his practice there and how he had difficulty with English judges and how he was representing those who were detained at that point in time and how he used to fight with judges. And, you know, he did very interesting things in his life. And we were part of that story. So law was, in a sense, running in my blood. There was no way in the world I wouldn't do law. I had decided even then that I would. Not because of anything else, because of the wonderful stories we heard from him and the principles that he embraced throughout his life. The profession of law has changed enormously. We don't have those stalwarts anymore. We have today senior counsel who ring up clients and say, send the brief to me. You know, who hanker for briefs. You know, people of that caliber would never even think of these things. So I was bred up in that and I wanted to, and I would have embraced, I wanted to embrace all that he did in his life. And he was at the top of his profession in that part of the country for about 40 years. And because of the fact that we were involved in poetry and literature, much of that has been imbibed by me from him. He in fact, in Manto's case, he was the lawyer for Manto in the obscenity trial in Lahore. Faiz Ahmed Faiz was a witness. They became friends. And at home, my eldest brother was, of course, an encyclopedia as far as Urdu poetry is concerned, because they were all brought up there. So that's the environment in which we were brought up. And let me just correct one fact. It's not me who got the Padma Bhushan, it's my father.
Sir, please tell us this. When you completed your law in the early 70s, did you go and practice under somebody or did you go for independent practice? And did you directly come to the Supreme Court? Please give us the roadmap, sir. How did you...
Actually, what happened was that in 1972, I had completed my law degree.
Yes,
I was also teaching at Hindu College.
Yes.
And I had also passed the IAS examination.
Yes.
So I had three options in my life and what course I was to follow. I had absolutely no doubt in my mind that I would want to do law. I wanted to do law. So I sent a letter. I didn't even go to the academy. And those days, nobody refused an IAS job because there was no private sector really worth the name at that point in time. So I wrote a letter saying, I don't want to join the academy. I resigned my teaching profession. And really, you know, I became a teacher because of this great historian who brought me into this job.
Mr. Bipin Chandra, I presume?
Bipin Chandra, yes. And he was very, you know, I was very dear to him. I was one of his, you know, He was very fond of me as a student. He taught me in Delhi University. So when I decided to do law, my father said, don't please do law in Chandigarh. I don't want you around. You know, in the meantime, he had built a house in Delhi because he wanted to shift to Delhi. But because I decided to do law, he said, okay, forget about me. I won't shift to Delhi. You go to Delhi. And he said, swim. The ocean is there for you to swim. I'm going to help you. All that I'm going to give you is a library, right? And that's it. Now, you swim or you drown is something that you have to do yourself. That's what he did, you know, when he was in Lahore. He's a first generation lawyer. So that's what I did. I came to Delhi and I was a briefless lawyer. I had no work. And remember, I never went to Chandigarh to solicit work. I never went. And hardly any work came to me from Chandigarh. That's how it all happened. And I decided not to join anybody. I decided never to file a Vakalatnama in my life. So I've never filed a Vakalatnama. I have never gone to a senior's chamber. I started as a briefless lawyer and would die as a briefless lawyer.
I'm glad, sir, you opted for law, and I'm glad it has been a loss of the civil services and academia that we have Kapil Sibal in the Supreme Court. You know, thank God for that. You know, sir, and sir, please tell us this, sir. I remember you telling us once that there is a perceptible difference between a great lawyer and a great advocate, as in a difference between lawyering and the skills of advocacy. So can you just tell us what are the differences, because people use these two terms interchangeably? And who, in your view, would be the best lawyer or the best advocate that you've seen in your
career? I have worked with the best advocate in the country and the country has ever produced. I've also worked with the best lawyer that this country, I think, has ever produced.
Yes.
And the two names are Nani Palkhivala for the best arguing counsel this country will ever see. Palkhivala. And A.K. Sen is the best lawyer that this country will ever see. He was an encyclopedia on the law. His understanding of the law was far better than any of his colleagues and any of his contemporaries. And both of them were very fond of me. And just as a matter of interest to you, he treated me like his own son. He would call me to his chamber and say, son, this is how you draft a plaint, you know, and he would teach me. And so did Mr. Palkhivala. I remember when I was a lawyer in the Haryana-Punjab water dispute, Palkhivala was to lead for Haryana and to set the stage for resolution of that dispute. So he came to the first hearing and he argued for about a couple of hours. And then he went back and then he told the client, I'm not going to appear anymore. Sibal will do the matter. And I was a young man. He was very, very fond of me. And so I've had enormous encouragement from stalwarts in the profession and enormous love from judges of the court. That's another aspect that perhaps people don't know. Judges of that time had the capacity to listen, partly because of the fact that there was not that kind of pressure in court, but they had the capacity to listen. And it's that capacity that made me a lawyer. Now, what's the difference between lawyering and advocacy? Advocacy is the ability to persuade, the ability to simplify the most complex issue so that a layman can understand. That's an art that very few people have. Most people get lost in verbiage. Most people get lost in the language of the law. But remember that ultimately the law is nothing but common sense. The law is nothing but a reality, but it's nothing but dealing with reality on the ground. And the reality on the ground is extremely clear in every aspect. You can see it. And if you can see the law in that fashion, you will be a great advocate. To be a great lawyer is to understand the reality and encapsulate the principles of law evolved over time in English courts and other jurisdictions and put it in an Indian context so that you have the treasure of those principles applied to the Indian context. And I think A.K. Sen was, outstanding in that regard.
Great, great. So now that you've spoken about Palkhiwala, sir, we all would be grateful to him because of the basic structure doctrine that he argued in Keshavan and Bharti 1973. At that point of time, sir, when this doctrine did come out in 1973 in that famous judgment, you were very new into this profession. Did you visualize that the basic structure doctrine would be such a key cornerstone of Indian constitutionalism?
No.
And how it has evolved over the period of time?
No, I didn't visualize it at all. I never imagined. But you see, he was a genius. Palkhiwala was a genius. And you know, evolved that story because the court was set to give this power to parliament to amend any part of the constitution.
Yes.
And you know, it was really a roadblock to an authoritarian mindset, right? Which could have led to the destruction of democracy in the years to come. Unfortunately, today, you don't need the law to destroy democracy. You see, today, democracy is being destroyed without an amendment to the Constitution. Because it's de facto being destroyed because people have captured institutions. But that was a great moment. I was in court. I was in court listening to Nani. And it was mesmerizing. His arguments were mesmerizing. And you know, the court really had no answer. And of course, he saved us from the destruction of democracy. That's his legacy to the nation.
So from one mesmerizing performance, please permit me to go to another mesmerizing performance. This would be in early 1990s when you defended a Supreme Court judge who was facing impeachment proceedings in the parliament. You know, that's where the entire nation stood up and noticed Mr. Kapil Sibal and his intuitive legal genius. So can you please tell our young viewers as to what was those impeachment proceedings and how did you come about to defend Justice Ramaswamy then?
Well, you know, sometimes success comes with opportunities. And sometimes when you take up those opportunities, despite great opposition, you don't realize where it will lead you to. And that's exactly what happened. And I'll give you a little history of this. Yeah. What happened was that Ramaswamy's father was Veeraswamy.
Okay.
Justice Veeraswamy was being sought to be criminally prosecuted for alleged corruption.
The famous Veeraswamy judgment, sir. K. Veeraswamy.
That's correct. So what happened one day was that I got a call from Justice Ramaswamy. Because by that time I had practiced in the Supreme Court and people, you know, the judges recognized me. And he said to me that I have a request to make. I said, what is it, sir? He said, look, I have given this brief to a senior lawyer and the matter is coming up on Monday. And I remember this was a Friday evening and the matter is coming up on Monday before a constitution bench. And I don't have a lawyer and I can't think of anybody else except you. Will you please take the brief? So then I argued Veeraswamy's case for the constitution bench. I lost the matter by a 3-2 judgment. Justice Verma ruled in my favor. He was the dissenting judge. And then when Ramaswamy himself got into trouble, then of course, naturally he came to me. And at that point in time, the entire bar, the entire nation, the entire opposition was against the judge because, you know, as you know, that the media decides the fate of many people.
Even then.
So what happened was that, and of course, Shri Shanti Bhushan, who I respect greatly, was on the other side, and the entire bar was on the other side. And I remember one day standing in the corridor in Shanti Bhushan, he came to me and he said, why are you defending this man? I said, sir, I'm just defending somebody who needs help. He said, no, we'll destroy him and we'll destroy you. I said, sir, why? I'm a young lawyer. Why do you want to destroy me? I'm just doing a matter. He said, no, I'll see what we do to your client. So when the matter came up in court, we started filing petitions and we say, please hear us. Because as you know, under the Judges Inquiry Act, a committee is set up.
Yes.
So I told the judges, I said, give me a hearing now. The matter should not go to the committee. The judges said no. we won't hear you now, we'll hear you after the committee renders its finding. Then when the committee rendered its finding and the matter came back to the Supreme Court, then I said, hear me now, please. They said, no, we won't hear you because now the committee has found against you. Now we are sending this to Parliament for the motion to be moved. I said, will my client never be heard? He said, you can ask Parliament to hear you. I said, why will Parliament give me a hearing? He said, okay, we will write in our judgment that if he can be represented either by himself or by a lawyer. That's how I got a hearing in Parliament. And Shanti Bhushan gave me that opportunity. And I'm thankful to him for doing that for me. So in May 1993, that famous impeachment motion was moved. And one day I'd write about it as to what happened behind the doors.
And you won that, sir. Ultimately,
yes, we succeeded.
You successful.
I argued for about 5.5 to 6 hours before Parliament.
So that was your first innings as a, even before you were elected as a parliamentarian, you managed to hold forth in the parliament for 5-6 hours. So that's a rare achievement. I don't think any parliamentarian can lay claim to that, to have stood.
No, I think there is only one instance in the world, and that's in Australia where a lawyer represented. Right. But otherwise, there are no such instances.
Right. Yeah. So another aspect, sir, another area of law which is quite troubling these days. And since you're a virtual encyclopedia on that, because you've appeared in all the matters in the Supreme Court pertaining to the Anti-Defection Act. This act came up in 1985, supposedly to prevent political defections. But in the recent past, we have seen, and there's one example, one state where we are currently seeing it, where defections have become very endemic. So, sir, just can you please shed light on what are the drawbacks or what are the lacunas in the Anti-Defection Act that despite 35 years, why have you not able to address the problem?
The problem is very simple. You see, at the heart of it is the hunger for power. At the heart of it is the hunger of power. And at the heart of it is also the human greed to aggrandize. Right? So it is these two elements which play a significant role in all defections. The hunger for power is to topple governments, even elected governments. And the hunger for greed is to allow yourself to be sold out. Right? These are the two elements. And no law can prevent it. How can law prevent it? If somebody in the midst of having been elected from a party decides to, for reasons that you all know and I know, to destabilize a government because of personal ambition, then no 10th schedule, no constitution can stop it. And that's what Ambedkar said. You know, we've given you a fabulous constitution, but the question is that its objectives will never be realized. It will be far away from the pain that people go through on a daily basis, which is, to reduce that pain is what the constitution is all about. If the people who run governments don't adhere to the principles underlying the constitution, and no government, very few governments have ever catered to those objectives. And that's why the 10th schedule, the only way to deal with this is to have a provision that anybody who defects, yes, he has a right to defect, no problem. But he will not hold public office for 5 years. And he will not be entitled to fight the next election. Right? Previously, you could break away, one third could break away, and that would be a recognized faction. We amended that. Now it's two thirds. Right? So it becomes difficult for two thirds to break away. So people now, elected representatives, send their resignations to the speaker. And they say, now you accept our resignation. Because even if you are disqualified, that disqualification is only till the term of the assembly in which you are elected or parliament in which you are elected. For the next election, that disqualification has no meaning. So the two elements that need to change is that you cannot fight the next election and you cannot hold public office. And that will sort of solve the problem.
So, in fact, one of the main facets of our constitution, the unique facet of our constitution, is the collegium system. So what are your views on it, sir? Do you support the collusion system of judges, appointing judges to insulate them from executive interference?
So I think
DGAC was a better idea. So what are your...
All right. Let me put it in perspective. See, who are the people who decide these things? They are human beings, right? Human beings who have their own frailties, whether it's judges of the Supreme Court or judges of the High Court or government. You give this power to the government, they will misuse it, right? And if you don't have people who should follow, when a person becomes a judge of the Supreme Court, I think that's the acme of his success. You know, he must give up his personal likes and dislikes. But over the years, we've seen that not happening. And we see the kind of things that the government did, sometimes perhaps worse, what the collegium does. So it's only men and the principles that they embrace will ensure that the waters are not muddied.
So recently we've seen a lot of interplay between Article 25 and 26, which rights on one hand, vis-a-vis Article 14 and 21 rights on the other. For example, Sabarimala was a classic example where one group pleaded that against the entry of menstruating women in the temple, and the based on their rights under Article 25 and 26, their right to freedom of religion. And the other group, which were pro-entry group, which said that this directly violates 14 and 21. So how do you reconcile this, sir? And what are your views on this?
See, I personally think, and you know, this is true of Article 370, 2 of 377 that was abolished. See, ultimately, unless there is change within society, you'll never be able to realize the objectives of society. So when you talk of Sabarimala, quite frankly, if you ask me, I don't think courts should even enter this area. I'll tell you why. Because whatever judgment you render, it has an enormous impact in society, because society lives in one era and the law is in another era, right? And there's a huge gap in between, right? You strike down 377, but on the ground, what do the policemen do? On the ground, how does your neighbor look at you? On the ground, how do people, knowing that your sexual preferences are different, how do they treat you or deal with you, right? It's that must change, and that comes with education. That comes with social transformation. That comes with social movements. That comes with, people thinking differently. You can sort of lay down any kind of law. It will have no impact on the ground unless you change societal mindsets. And that's the problem. That's the problem with 377.
So, but wouldn't a Supreme Court judgment contribute towards some change in the societal mindset, sir?
It like the privacy judgment. It's a great judgment. It sort of lays down the law in glorious terms. But what happens to privacy in the household, on the ground? Every day, on a daily basis, the policeman, violates that privacy. Every day, entities violate that privacy. People investigate, take your mobile phone. And when they take your mobile phone, they have access to everything that you have. Has anybody heard that that's a violation of privacy? Again, that's something that must be taught to investigators. That's something that must be taught to those our prosecuting agencies. That must be something that must be inherent in the mindset of our judges when it comes to real issues. You can lay down a beautiful, ornate legal proposition and sort of flower it with beautiful words. But on the ground, things are ugly. That's what needs to be done.
So there's another very interesting facet that came out in recent times, when the recent conflict between India and China, And we had a couple of very reputed senior counsels saying that they would not appear for Chinese companies. So we have a very young viewership. Most of the viewers of this webinar are ones who are in law college or just passed out of law. And this is always a vexed question. When should a lawyer, and this is, I put this to you because you've always been a lawyer for the underdog. And I personally know that you've appeared for so many of them and pro bono. Kindly just guide us on this as to when should a lawyer take up a brief or when, and when should a lawyer is justified in refusing the brief?
Let me answer that question by a simple example.
Yes.
When Kasab was here,
yes, sir.
And what Kasab did was for all to see. Why did the state give him a lawyer? That's the answer to your question. That even a terrorist is entitled.
So, sir, then by that yardstick, sir, are the senior counsels or lawyers justified in taking a stand that it does not appeal to my conscience?
Well, I don't know whether they are justified or not, but whatever their feelings are, they shouldn't have made them public. You may not take a brief for whatever reason, but you don't have to prove your nationalism.
Nationalism.
In public.
So, and so if you could also just shed some light on the recent judgment of the Supreme Court on the internet restrictions in Kashmir, the scrapping of 370. You know, Kashmir is something that since last year is always on the boil and it has tremendous legal implications. So what are your views on that, sir?
I have very strong views on it. You can't treat your citizens differently as long as you recognize them as your citizens. Right? Not everybody in Kashmir is a potential terrorist or a terrorist. Right? I'm not denying the fact that there are lots of elements in Kashmir which would enable terrorist activities to take place. And I don't think that we should hesitate to deal with them in the manner that they should be dealt with. Right? But you can't for millions of people. You can't say you're not entitled to your fundamental rights. And it's unfortunate that even a judgment of the Supreme Court is not being implemented.
Did you find the Supreme Court proactive in defending our fundamental rights in the earlier decades compared to the recent times? Any comparative?
Oh, yes. Actually, the decade when Justice Bhagwati and Chandrachud and other judges were there was actually the decade where public interest litigation in the true sense of the word changed mindsets as well. Bandhua Mukti Morcha, Justice Bhagwati was always thinking of the underprivileged, the marginalized, those who have no access to justice. That's where public interest litigation has a role to play. But now public interest litigation has become a competitive enterprise where you want to down somebody else, business interests are involved. And I think that the court needs to, many people use public interest litigation to destroy even elected governments and elected representatives. I don't say that you shouldn't deal with them, but the question is, what happens is that the investigating agencies are beholden to you. You use the investigating agencies to target corruption amongst one set of people and protect corruption amongst another set of people. And then you file a public interest litigation and say, court should investigate this man or this entity. But when that same public interest litigation is filed against the powers that be, courts don't take it forward. Now, this is also a very disturbing trend.
And how do you, sir, how do we, the recent times where we have seen what you've just rightly pointed out, the Enforcement Directorate, the Income Tax, the CBI, sir, how do you insulate them against political interference? Sir?
You can't. Again, we go back to the question I raised. Ultimately, it's the integrity of the human being, the values of that person when he holds a public post, the principles that he adheres to, what his conscience tells him, what he should be doing, should not be doing. And that's true of lawyers. That's true of doctors. Why is it that lawyering also has lost its charm? Because of the enormous malpractices that have crept into this profession, because we moved away. It's no longer a service profession. It's a profession where we aggrandize wealth. It's a profession where we hanker after goodies, hanker after our name in newspapers, hanker after public opinion and say, okay, I don't think this is good for me if I do this matter. That's not what the profession was supposed to be. That's not why we have the legal profession. That's true of doctors, that's true of chartered accountants as well. That's true of all professions in this country now. And I think it's time for us to realize that we are doing great injustice, not just to ourselves, not just to our professions, but to the future of India.
So talking of public opinion, sir, now these days a major driver of public opinion are the television channels. And compared to, say, even a decade earlier, you know, when are the television anchors and the hosts who used to play a neutral role, who may have certain strong beliefs, but they used to play the role of an umpire, of an arbitrator, of trying to have two conflicting views before the viewers to make up their minds for. We now have a trend of very assertive, if I can put that very polite, in most polite terms, very assertive anchors who take a very strong, quote-unquote, nationalist position, very strong. So how
this is nothing to do with the media, it's politics. This is not media. This is politics.
But the question was is that now we are witnessing FIRs against such set of anchors. Now, there are one set of anchors who come and say that we have spoken something against the government, therefore we are being victimized. So how do you, sir, considering you had an occasion to appear in several such matters, how do you balance the right of an anchor or the media under Article 19 vis-a-vis the context or the content of what he is speaking, which may have some incendiary...
First of all, I think judicial principles must be evolved. As to what then is the remit of the media. This argument that the media can do anything it likes and it's freedom of speech. It's no longer free speech, it's commercial speech.
Okay.
Why is it commercial speech? Because it's big business that backs you. It's the politics that backs you. Right? It's the big bucks that back you. What's free speech? You say what they want you to say. So it's time for the court to start looking at this issue from a different standpoint and setting standards. Otherwise, again, as I said, democracy will be bastardized as it is being bastardized. So ultimately, the systems must change because of the men in those systems must adhere to principles. I'll give you a little short snippet that I wrote. It's a poem that I wrote on the present status of society. And it's something to do with lawyers as well. It says, kis kis ka sahara lo? Kanun to hathiyar ban gaya hai. Kis kis ka sahara lo? Kanun to hathiyar ban gaya hai. Ab to shahar mein bekasoor bhi gunegar ban gaya hai. Ab to shahar mein bekasoor bhi gunegar ban gaya hai. Chal raha tha befikr hokar ghar ki sadak pe main. Usi sadak pe hinsa ek tyohar ban gaya hai. हिफाजत करने वाला भीड़ में खोया दिखा हिफाजत करने वाला द पुलिसमैन हिफाजत करने वाला भीड़ में खोया दिखा कहते हैं वो भी अब साहूकार बन गया इंसाफ कैसे मिले मुझे इस बात पे तू गौर कर इंसाफ कैसे मिले मुझे इस बात पे तू गौर कर गवाह मुकर के सरकारी पैरोकार बन गया खौफ में गुजर जाएगा कब्र तक रास्ता मेरा खौफ में गुजर जाएगा कब्र तक रास्ता मेरा तेरी नजर में मासूम भी शैतान बन गया
great. So on that note, sir, may I just bring in Shivang, sir, our co-moderator for the afternoon. He would also, sir, like to ask a few questions. So, Shivang, over to you.
I would be asking some questions on your personal life.
Sure. I can't. Your voice is breaking. I think that people need to sort of put off their audios.
Just a
I can't hear you, sir.
Yeah, now, sir?
Yes, now I can.
Sorry for the disturbance. I'm going to ask you questions about your personal likes and dislikes.
Yeah.
Like, you all know your affinity about your arts and poetry. You have written so many couplets. You have authored songs as well. So how it has transformed you as a lawyer? How much it has helped you as a person to become a great lawyer that you are now?
I don't know whether I'm a great lawyer or not, but I am a very emotive human being. I feel for people. I feel the pain of people. I feel for my fellow human beings. And that's led me to, and that's partly because of my family background, my father, his sort of love for poetry, my brother's love for literature. And therefore, about 10 years ago, I decided that I would sort of, you know, start penning my thoughts. And this is only an enterprise I started about 10 years ago. So I have a large collection of private songs that I have composed, lyrics that I have composed, which have been sung by great people. I mean, top singers of this country, including Hariharan, Arijit, Lata. There's a particular movie called Shorgul recently, which had a song of mine. If you have it, you can play it for a minute or so.
I would request the host to play a part of the song. Can we have it?
Sure, sir. Just a moment.
Sung by Arijit, and yes. The music is by Niladri, who is one of the greatest, sitarists.
Just a moment.
I have heard the song. It's a very beautiful song. Let us all enjoy it. This is one aspect that nobody knows. I think
I shared it with very few people, but since you asked me, so I've decided to share a bit of it with you.
Great. I would want to ask, like, you have donned so many hats. You have been a lawyer, you have been a politician. Now we have heard that you write songs, you are a poet as well. Which one of these things do you enjoy the most?
See, it's like, all right. So when you are wooing a woman, I think you don't see anything else. Right? You just woo the woman. Right? And that's what happens when you put in your best in anything that you do. Right? When I am writing, I concentrate only on the quality of the writing. When I'm in politics, I forget the law. Right? I do politics. When I'm in court, I never do politics. I only concentrate on the law. When I'm writing poetry, I don't think of the law. So you must be fully absorbed in whatever you do in life. You must give your 100%. Remember, ultimately, life is about perspiration, right? It's about perspiration and inspiration. without perspiration, without inspiration. And inspiration comes from what? From values. If you have no values, you never have inspiration. If you have no principles, you'll always be thinking of yourself and how to get ahead. Inspiration comes from pain. Recognizing pain is a good human being's essential quality. If you ask me, when I was a teacher, I was concentrating only on teaching my students. So each activity that I do, I'm fully absorbed in it. And I cannot say that, look, I like this or that. I love the law. I love poetry. I love writing lyrics. I love teaching. I love doing politics.
Who was your inspiration for this song? I would personally want to know.
No inspiration. No, it's when you have to be observant.
Okay.
Right? You have to understand somebody else's feelings in that position. And then you sort of articulate it in this particular fashion. I mean, I've written a lot of poems on politics as well.
Yes, we just have heard that.
Is there any other poems around politics or any other poem that you'd like?
I've already got a lot of people against me. Now you'll get all the politicians against me.
So there was a title given to you as Kapilus Sibilus at your college days. How was it? How did you get that title?
Actually, you know, that was not a title. Very few people use that expression. And the reason why they use that expression is because I did a lot of plays in college. I used to act in a lot of plays in college. I was, you know, especially we used to do a Shakespeare play every year. And I was in all of them, almost every play. So I had a great flair for acting at that point in time. Later in the university, when I was teaching, I was directing plays in the university. I directed a play for the Delhi School of Economics. I directed a play in Miranda House. I directed a play Lady Sriram College, Lady Irwin College, sorry. So I was deeply involved in theatre. In the context of my being involved with Shakespearean theatre, some people used to call me Kapilius Sibilius, right? But the more common name which people used to call me for was called Hattil, because my word starts with cap. So a lot of people used to call me Hattil instead of Kapil.
So again, my next question is, like, that you're both your sons, Mr. Akhil Sibal and Mr. Amit Sibal, they both are lawyers. They both are designated senior lawyers. You yourself is a designated senior lawyer for so many years. And living with three senior lawyers in the same roof, how does it work out for you, all of you?
First of all, we don't live under the same roof. Each of them are separate. They have their own professions. They have their own lives. And nowadays, because of the good thing about this lockdown is that you get to talk to your children far more often, because otherwise they are far too busy to even talk to me. So now I get the opportunity to chat with them and to chat with my grandchildren. But I don't want to say anything more. It's not good to talk about your family publicly. But I'm happy.
I wouldn't like that.
That they are doing what they are doing. And the most important thing is happy about the fact that they are doing it with a value system that the family has cherished over the years.
So they're carrying the tradition of Mr. H.K. Sibal, sir.
H.L. Sibal.
H.L. Sibal. Sir, I would like to know your thoughts on the recent encounter that has happened in the state of UP of Vikas Dubé. Do you think encounter is a valid tool?
My God, how can you ever say that? A democracy governed by the rule of law can ever accept encounter as a valid rule for doing justice? I mean, I think it's the most barbaric way. Then how are you different from countries where people cut off your hands for stealing? You're no different from them. While you criticize them, you endorse something that is unacceptable. In any democracy, should be unacceptable in any political system. And I'm sorry that that courts have so far not come down heavily. They don't even see. It's time for courts to realize that slowly and slowly, democracy is being destroyed in India through political tools, whether it's using the 10th schedule to their advantage, or using money power to topple governments, or these encounters, or spreading fear in a section of the community. These are tools to destroy the equanimity of India. These are tools to destroy the conscience of our constitution. These are tools to destroy the future of our generations. I think courts must recognize this fact and take up matters suo motu, because they are the only institution that can stem this tide of barbarism.
How about the media celebrating the instant justice, what they call it?
That's where the court should come in. Exactly the point. Who else can come in?
Yes, sir.
You see, this is not freedom of speech. So, see, and lawyers must stand up. This is the other sad part. Where is the community of lawyers? We should have no politics in the bar. A professional does not belong to the Congress, does not belong. I may fight a case for the Congress, but I don't belong to the Congress as a lawyer. When it comes to democratic values, when it comes to upholding the values which our forefathers enshrined in our constitution, it is nothing to do with Congress. It's nothing to do with BJP. It's nothing to do with any other party. It's the value system with which generations must absorb as they take their steps into the future.
Correctly. So I would request now Mr. Sunil Fernandez to take over from here.
Yes, sir, just a couple of questions on just what you just said. So you've been a three-time member of the president of the Supreme Court Bar Association. So very few people would know that. You've, apart from being an illustrious senior counsel, you've headed the Bar Association for 3 years in the 90s. So what difference do you see between the quality of bar? Because we have had enough questions on senior advocates and judges. Now, please tell us lawyers, you know, what qualitative difference do you see from the 90s or from the time you started your practice and the present day lawyers?
Well, I tell you at the time when we started our practice, let me just give you a little, another very, very interesting snippet that most of you don't know. The first election that I fought, perhaps, or the second, for president of the bar was against A.K. Sen.
Oh, the same great lawyer that you just mentioned.
The same great lawyer, right? He was very fond of me. And I went up to him and I said, sir, I'm very sorry, but I'm going to file my candidature for president of the Supreme Court bar. He said, son, you must. You must do that. And I won that. A.K. Sen lost. And you know, he wrote a letter to me. And he said to me, young man, my dear Kapil, because he was very fond of me, he said, look, I'm so happy that you have won, because you were the more deserving candidate. As a young person, you can lead the Bar Association much better than I could have. That was the camaraderie between members of the bar. When I was president, I never took a decision unless it was unanimous. There was never any dissent in the 3 terms of my presidency. There was never any dissent in the executive body. Never. We stood up. But the whole scenario has changed. The whole scenario has changed. The bar is no longer the same.
We have to stand
for values
across party
lines and values enshrined in our constitution. You see, what ultimately, why are we part of this country? Because this country, our forefathers have given us a framework within which we must lead our lives. And that framework talks about equity. It talks about social justice. It talks about individual freedoms. It talks about sharing power. That's what this constitution is about. Now, the political parties here don't want to share power, right? They don't believe in social justice. They target communities. They don't believe in equity. And they crush individual freedoms. So all that is enshrined in our constitution, right, is slowly being destroyed by the actions of those who are in power. And the courts and the people of this country must realize that. And we as a nation must fight this trend.
So very wise words and very courageous words for you to advise us, the members of the bar, that we have to think as lawyers, as constitutionalists, across party lines and across ideologies when we don the robes. So on that note, I just wanted to know, is there any matter in your career which still rankles that you lost it? You know, had you just won it, probably the larger impact would have been there on the society or the nation.
There are many.
Yes.
There are many. You see, you must remember that judgments are not necessarily decided on the basis of law. I'm sorry, I'm saying that. Right? There are lots of things that are in a judge's mind which will not be reflected in gold print. I don't mean any disrespect to judges, but that's the way it is. Right? And I'll give you a little story, and a story, I'll detail it out on some other occasion, but the story is that I lost a case I shouldn't have lost. I know I shouldn't have lost. And two of the three judges also know I shouldn't have lost. So many years later, one of the two judges said to me that you shouldn't have lost that case. Right? And the second one also came to me and said you shouldn't have lost that case. That's a couple of years later. And then they told me why I lost it. And it had nothing to do with the law. Right? Remember that. If you lose a case, don't be disheartened. It's not because the law is not on your side, because the judges were not on your side.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks for those golden words. And I think, sir, I'd give the podium back to Abhikalp. If you can give the concluding address in this, sir. We are very extremely thankful to you, sir, for the time that you've taken out.
Pleasure to be with you all, especially lawyers.
All questions candidly, sir. You've not been quote unquote politically correct while answering them. You've spoken your heart out, and we've at least speaking personally for myself, and I'm sure all the others who were a part of this webinar, they've learned a lot from you, sir. And we eagerly await the day when we come and you come out with your book of autobiography, so that you know we can learn.
In the evening of my life, there is no better thing. See, you have to be honest with yourself and honest with people who you relate to. If I can't be honest, I'm not. Why should I be a lawyer? I shouldn't be around. We have to change the system. We need to change the system. All of us must get together and do that. The system is being destroyed.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Kapil sir. Those indeed were very knowledgeable and illuminating words. I'm sure that just like me, even the other attendees were enthralled by those keen inputs and observations. I believe that since most of the participants for this session happen to be undergraduate students, they would surely have benefited from inputs and views, from your views, sir. I personally found the discussion around the concept of anti-defamation law, impeachment case of justice, discussion of the Kashmir issue, the way you described about media that now free speech has become commercial speech, really interesting. So in the end, on behalf of the CAN Foundation and the participants, I'm sincerely grateful to you for giving your valuable time and for having consented for the webinar. We would surely look up to more such brilliant endeavors in future, and I also hope that the foundation remains blessed with your benign blessing. So I would also like to thank Sunil sir and Shivang for taking out time and moderating this webinar. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Be safe, all of you. Be safe.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.